Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Director Natalia, Nina, thank you all very much for the invitation to come back to GAIN today. I see many familiar faces, so thank you very much. It feels a bit like coming home. And then I got off the plane this morning at 4:30, and at minus 20-something degrees, it did not feel like landing in London. It was a lot colder. But thank you very much for the invitation to come back today. I actually was just in America last week, and so we can more than happy when we have some questions and answers to try start thinking about the implication of the new administration for energy and oil in America, but for globally as well. Many of you would have seen, either come to presentations I've given in the past or my predecessor has given in the past about the energy outlook. So as you know, in the energy outlook, we look ahead for the next 20 years and try to think about the key global trends shaping the energy system over that period. And the obvious question that raises is, why bother to do this? Why does BP bother to spend the time and effort trying to produce the energy outlook? And the simple answer is because it helps us. We do this primarily to help our own internal decision-making, our own internal strategic analysis. Last year, BP cut back its investment spending very heavily, and it still invested something like $17 billion. It is only in the oil and gas industry that you say billion and people don't look at you with a frown brow thinking you've got the numbers and units wrong. It's an enormous sums of money over a long period of time. With very long-term investments. So thinking about these energy systems is important. Now, do we have a crystal ball that somehow means that we can forecast perfectly for 20 years ahead? No, of course not. Of course we know that any single forecast will be wrong, inevitably it will be wrong. But I don't think that's the way to think about forecasting. I don't think we should think about forecasting as being right or wrong. The value of forecasting is to better understand the nature of the uncertainty we face. And so much of the analysis in the energy outlook isn't about the precise point forecast, but is exploring the range of uncertainties around that projection. We base it around a base case of a most likely central path, but we use that central path to then allow us to explore the uncertainty around it. Perhaps one other point, as Natalia said, the contours of this year's energy outlook, the main features of this year's energy outlook, aren't that different from last year's. And so, in some sense, you would be worried if you produced a forecast for 20 years ahead, and each year it moved around a lot, you would be very worried by that. So, but even though the main contours of the forecast haven't changed, the questions you want to ask about the future change a lot every year. And so the presentation I'll give you today will be quite different to the presentation I gave you last year, not because the shape has changed, but because the questions which arise which are important for your strategic thinking are different this year than they were last year. So that's why we do it, to help our thinking, to ask questions about the future, to think about the uncertainty. The question then is, well, why publish this? Why publish the document? If it's so helpful for BP's analysis and decision-making, why not just keep it internal and keep it to yourself? And the answer to that is because I don't know of any better discipline on your thinking, on anyone's thinking, than to expose it to external scrutiny. I was in Washington and DC last week. I'm in Moscow the beginning of this week. I'm in Brussels at the end of this week. I'm in somewhere else next week. As I make those presentations, people will point out which bits of the analysis are right, and Typically, they don't say that very often. Very often, they're quite keen to tell me which bits of the analysis doesn't make sense, isn't quite right. As a result of which, I go back to London at the end of this, more informed, understanding things better, and as a result of which, BP will make better analysis and decisions as a result of it. That's why we publish it, for an internal scrutiny. That's a code of saying that when we get to the questions and answers, please feel free to point out the bits that you don't think make sense. My experience of talking at the Institute over the last few years means I know you will do, but as a result of which I will go back more informed than I otherwise would have done. Okay, so that's a little bit of background. To start off, just some background in terms of the economic backdrop underpinning this year's energy outlook. We expect global GDP to grow by around 3.4% on average per year over the outlook on a PPP basis. Some of that growth is driven by population growth, but the majority of the growth is driven by productivity, shown in those yellow bars on the left. So mainly driven by productivity growth, particularly in emerging Asia economies led by China and India, as those fast-growing emerging Asian economies increase their levels of capital and adopt best practice techniques from the productivity frontier. So this is a story of steady global GDP growth led by increasing prosperity. As that productivity increases, incomes per head increase, leading to increasing prosperity. And we estimate that something like 2 billion people, around a quarter of the world's population, will be lifted out of low incomes into middle incomes over the next 20 years. And that increasing prosperity is a sort of key driver of the story underpinning the energy outlook. In particular, that growing middle class, that burgeoning middle class, particularly in Asia, drives a growth in energy demand. We expect global energy demand to increase by around 30% by 2035. Virtually all of that growth comes from emerging economies. Plentiful supplies of energy enable this increase in prosperity, enable this increase in this rising living standards, this greater access to energy. So in that sense, the increase in energy is a good news story. It's reflective of increasing prosperity, billions of people being lifted out of low incomes, high levels of living standards, increasing levels of increasing access to energy. In contrast, if you look at the energy demand within the OECD, shown here by this green swathe, is essentially flat. So energy demand within the developed economies, flat to falling, all of the growth coming from the emerging economies. We expect the growth in total energy demand, shown on the right-hand side here in the purple line, to slow relative to the last 20 or 30 years. GDP growth, as shown by the yellow line, is similar to the past, but what we're seeing is the pace of declines in energy intensity, the amount of energy required to produce each unit of GDP, those declines are expected to get bigger and bigger over time. You see here by those green bars on the right-hand side growing over time. Some of that reflects the particular features of what's going on in China, as a pattern of growth in China starts to shift away from the industrial sector, which is very energy intensive, towards services and consumer-facing growth, which is less energy intensive. But more generally reflects a worldwide, increased focus worldwide on improving energy efficiency as countries try to achieve the goals set out in Paris. So if global energy demand is increasing by around 30%, what fuels are increasing to meet that increased demand? The story in terms of the fuel mix is one in which the fuel mix is gradually the gradual sort of continuation in the decarbonisation of the fuel mix. This is led by renewable energy, shown here in the orange swathes and the orange line. So renewable energy, we separate out hydro. So renewable energy here is particularly wind, solar and biofuels, growing by over 7% a year, with renewable energy almost quadrupling over this period of time. And the underlying story here is one of an increasing competitiveness, particularly of wind and solar, so that wind and solar is able to compete against gas and coal in the power sector, increasingly without any need for public support or subsidies. This strong growth in renewable energy, together with continued steady growth in nuclear energy and hydro, mean non-fossil fuels altogether provide almost half of the increase in primary energy over the next 20 years. So non-fossil fuels providing almost half of the increase in energy. Even so, oil and gas, together with coal, still provide the majority of the world's energy needs, accounting for a little more than three quarters of the total energy by 2035. That compares with about an 86% today accounted by fossil fuels. So that's declining from around 86% today to around 77%. So declining share of fossil fuels, but even so, fossil fuels remaining the dominant source of energy driving the global economy. As you can see here in the chart on the left, showing natural gas in red, or in on the right here, sorry. Natural gas we expect to grow far more quickly than either oil or coal, overtaking coal to be the second largest fuel source by the end of the outlook. Oil demand increases throughout the outlook, but the growth in oil demand is expected to slow. Coal has the sharpest break with the past. It has the sharpest sort of slowdown relative to the growth of the past. We expect coal to grow at less than a tenth of the rate seen over the last 20 years, with global coal consumption expected to peak in the mid-2020s. So sharp shift, a change in the fortunes of coal, and the key driver of those changing fortunes is, of course, China. So in China, the combination of the changing pace and pattern of growth, so GDP growth slowing and also shifting to less energy-intensive sectors, together with the commitment to reduce the dependency of coal, means we expect to see a sharp slowing in the growth rate of Chinese coal consumption. If you look at the chart on the left here, you see those really strong growth of the 90s and the noughties, where essentially coal powered the industrialisation of China. Those days are over. And so as we look ahead, we'd expect to see a sharp slowing in the growth of Chinese coal consumption, and eventually Chinese coal consumption starting to decline. As a result of which, as you can see on the right-hand chart here, China's dependency of coal declines from around two-thirds today to around 45% by the end of the outlook. That first 5 years of that decline is pretty much exactly in line with the five-year plan just announced in China. And when I'm in China and I've shown them charts similar to this, if I've shown them to something like the NDRC, they will sort of nod and say this is broadly in line with the sort of pattern they expect to see. China, the risk of stating the obvious to this group, China, what happens in China really matters for global energy. It's by far and away the world's largest market for energy, consuming close to a quarter of global energy. It's by far and away, over the last 10 or 15 years, been the largest growth market for energy. And these shifting trends within China, these changing energy needs, have important bearing on a lot of the trends that we map out in this year's energy outlook. So these changing trends in China cast a significant shadow across many of the global trends that we map out in the outlook. One other feature of this year's outlook is the fact that the world continues to electrify, with the share of power, the share of energy used for power continuing to increase. We expect that something like two-thirds of the increase in energy over the 20-year period will be absorbed, will go into the power sector, around two-thirds of the increase. In this year's Energy Outlook, we have a new section of the Outlook which looks beyond 2035 to some of the trends which may happen in the sort of 15 or 20-year period leading up to 2050. And on a simple extrapolation of this trend, we think upwards of around 80% of the increase in primary energy in the 10 or 15 years up to 2050 could be absorbed by the power sector. So a very, very large majority of the increase in power as we go increase in primary energy as we go forward will be absorbed by the power sector. As a result, I think in future years, we will have to devote increasing space in the energy outlook to thinking about the role of the power sector in determining the shape and form of the energy transition. It seems to me that if any students who are thinking hard about the nature and pace and form of the energy transition over the next 15, 20, 30 years will have to think very hard about the role of the power sector in that, because it will play such a key role in terms of absorbing increases in primary energy. That provides a sort of very quick overview of this year's outlook. What I plan to do now is to spend a little bit more time thinking about the outlook for oil, and then for gas, and then I'll bring that together by thinking about the implications that has for the outlook for carbon and the possibility of achieving the targets set out in Paris. If we start with oil, I want to frame the discussion of oil around sort of two key questions which have a key bearing on the energy outlook. First, how might electric cars and what I would call the broader mobility revolution affect the car market and hence the demand for oil? Just how big could those effects be? And secondly, how might a combination of slowing oil demand together with the abundance of oil resources affect the behaviour of low-cost oil producers? So they're the two questions I'm going to focus around. If we start with oil demand, and just to provide some context, in our base case, oil demand is projected to grow throughout the outlook, rising by around 15 million barrels a day. So from around 95 million barrels a day today to around 110. Transport demand accounts for around two-thirds of that growth. But as you can see in those sort of darker blue bars on the right-hand side here, the stimulus from transport gradually fades over time. And that's a key driver of that fading stimulus from transport is the assumption of increasing efficiency, particularly increasing vehicle efficiency. So as a result, we expect the increase, the pace of growth of oil demand to slow over the next 20 years. So in the near term, we expect annual increases of around 1 million barrels a day, and that's similar to what we had got used to in recent years, other than around the sort of most recent period with the low oil prices. So oil demand continues to increase at around 1 million barrels a day in the near term, but that's slowing to closer to around 0.4 by the end of the outlook. One other consequence of this slowing impetus from transport demand as you can see here in this chart on the right, is by the end of the outlook, the primary source of growth for oil demand by the end of the outlook is the non-combusted use of oil. The use of oil as a feedstock, particularly into the petrochemicals sector. And it's worth pausing just for a moment to just think about this, that point. So the suggestion here is that by the 2030s, the primary source of growth for oil will not be to power cars or planes or trains. It won't be as a fuel source at all, but rather it will be using oil as an input into other types of products like plastics or fabrics. So quite a significant change in terms of the growth of where the growth of oil demand is likely to come from over this period of time. So we go back to my question of electric cars and the implications electric cars may have. Just to provide some context here, oil demand for cars, you can see in the left-hand side, today accounts around 19 million barrels a day of oil demand. So that's around 20% of total oil demand. So that's the sort of orders of magnitude we're thinking about here when we talk about car demand. Now, in general, we expect the global car fleet to roughly double over the outlook, from around 0.9 billion cars today to around 1.8 billion cars in the future. And nearly all of that growth is coming from that emerging middle class I was telling you about earlier, with the number of cars in the developing world expected to triple over this period. So as you can see in the chart on the left, the vast majority of this growth is being driven from the developing world outside the non-OECD. In terms of electric cars, we expect electric cars to grow really rapidly. There's around 1 million electric cars today, and we expect electric cars to grow to around 100 million by 2035. So that's enormously rapid growth. That's compounding annual growth rates around 25% over the next 20 years to get that to 100 million electric cars. But as you can see in the chart here, even under that very strong growth rate, electric cars will still only account for a very small proportion of the total vehicle stock. So they still only account for around 5 or 6% of the total vehicle stock. And I'll come back to some of the uncertainty around that electric car estimate in a moment. But first of all, just to think about the implications this has for oil demand, this chart breaks down and builds up our forecasts for oil demand. So the way to read this chart is you read it from left to right. So you start on the left and you can see in 2015, oil demand for cars is around 90 million barrels a day. That doubling in the car fleet, in the global car park, other things equal, would roughly double the demand for oil, which is shown here by that green block. So it's doubling in the demand for oil. But that's massively offset by the assumptions of improving vehicle efficiency, which dramatically reduces the demand, the extent to which oil demand rises. The increase in electric cars also offsets the growth in oil demand, but the magnitude here is relatively small. 100 million cars reduces oil demand, we estimate, by somewhere between 1 and 1.5 million barrels of oil. Let me stand back and make sort of two general observations about this chart. So the first is my estimate of electric cars growing to 100 million electric cars by 2035. Am I confident in that estimate? Am I confident of that 100 million electric cars? Of course not. The number of unknowns you have to think about when estimating the number of electric cars is this enormous long list. You have to think about a key driver here is what happens to vehicle efficiency standards. What happens there? You then need to take account of battery costs, how quickly the battery costs come down. What happens to public support and subsidies for electric vehicles? Do that continue to carry on? Oil prices, how efficient can you be in improving the efficiency of the conventional car stock? And perhaps most difficult to estimate, but most importantly, consumers' preferences. Do consumers like electric vehicles because they think they're cool and they quite like driving around because they think it sort of says something about them and their responsibility towards the planet? Or are consumers scared of electric vehicles because they're worried that they're going to stop halfway along the motorway and they won't be able to recharge? How will consumer preferences change? That 100 million estimate, I think, is a plausible estimate, but there's obviously enormous confidence bands around that. But the point here is the numbers involved are relatively small. Suppose I'm really wrong. Suppose electric vehicles grow far, far more rapidly than I expect, two or three times more quickly than I expect, 200, 300 million. You're still only talking about a reduction of oil demand of around 3 or 4 million barrels a day in a market which is growing by 15 million barrels a day to 110. Electric cars on their own, even if they grow far, far more rapidly than we think, don't look like they're big enough to be a game changer for oil demand over the next 20 years. The second point which does leap out at you from this chart is what is far more significant here is what's going on in terms of vehicle efficiency. That's where the big driver is here. And the issue, the reason why vehicle efficiency is so important is because over the next 20 years, conventional cars account for the vast majority of the vehicle stock. And therefore, relatively small changes in efficiency can have very substantial implications. So two issues about vehicle efficiency. One is a source of uncertainty. In very rough terms, the efficiency of the vehicle, of the global vehicle fleet has improved on average around 1% a year. Over the last 10 or 15 years. We expect it to sort of improve at roughly double that rate over the next 20 years. That's what underpins this number. I think that makes sense, given the real preference of policymakers to use vehicle efficiency standards as a way of both trying to achieve carbon objectives and also improve urban air quality in terms of the technology which can be used, both in terms of electric vehicles, but also in conventional cars with mild hybridisation, lightweighting, and so on. But if when you're thinking that something's going to roughly double the rate of the past, it may be that the risks around this are on the upside. And so if vehicle efficiency improved just in line with the last 10 or 15 years, that yellow bar could be about half the size. And so oil demand could be, the growth in oil demand could be 7 or 8 million barrels higher than we expect. And so that vehicle efficiency is enormous, very important. And in some sense, the scope to get that wrong is far greater than the scope to go badly wrong, I think, on electric cars. Secondly, the other one is a small, more from a public policy perspective in terms of recognising the importance that vehicle efficiency can play in terms of reducing carbon emissions. I was on a platform panel interview recently in Germany, and I was sitting next to somebody, a politician from the Green Party. And all they wanted to talk about was the importance of electric cars in reducing carbon emissions. So I showed this chart and said, why do you want to keep focusing on electric vehicles? If you really, really want to think, you know, electric vehicles have a role to play here, especially over a 30, you know, 40, 50, 60 year period. But over the next 20 years, focusing on improving vehicle efficiency, you can make some really significant gains. And it's important that we don't lose sight of those efficiency arguments when thinking about the fuel switching argument in terms of electric cars. But electric cars are only a small part, are only part of a potentially a broader mobility revolution which could affect the car market and hence oil demand over the next 20 or 30 years. So when thinking about potential changes or the broader mobility revolution, as well as electric cars, I think we need to consider at least three other aspects of the mobility revolution. One is the introduction of autonomous vehicles, self-driving cars. And the importance of self-driving cars is they tend to be, a self-driving car is far more efficient in terms of the way it's driven than a normal car, and therefore reduces oil demand. The second issue here is what I call car sharing. So rather than each of us owning our own car, we all use something like Uber or something similar, and so we can share a car between us. I go to the grocery store, I come back, and then you can use the same car to go to a grocery store. In itself, car sharing doesn't reduce oil demand. We still both make separate trips to the grocery store. But what's special about car sharing is some cars are used more intensely than others. If the cars which are used more intensely tend to be a new technology car, they tend to be an electric car or a self-driving car, that effectively means that more miles are driven using a new technology car than a conventional car, and as a result it amplifies the impact of these new technologies. To make the maths very simple, suppose all autonomous cars were electric cars and they drive twice as much as a normal car. That's effectively the same as doubling the number of electric cars on the planet. And so car sharing has a massive amplification effect, which is worth thinking about. And the third mechanism is ride pooling. So not only do we use Uber to go to the grocery store, we go together and we share that journey, so we just reduce the number of individual journeys. In the outlook, we start trying to think through the potential mechanisms of how these different impacts may interact with each other. I'm not going to try and go through all of those scenarios now. In the questions and answers, I have some hidden slides, and I'm more than happy to if people would like. I guess two points up front. One is those scenarios are highly stylized. Trying to look ahead the next 20 years and think about how these different behaviours and technologies will evolve is clearly very uncertain. What we've done in the Outlook is produced a couple of scenarios to help us think through those issues, but in the back of the book, which you can download from bp.com, we've laid out all our assumptions, and those assumptions are pretty linear. So if you say, well, look, typical BP, they didn't get their scenario right, I've got a better scenario, you can use the framework at the back of the book and the calibrations at the back of the book to produce your own scenario. So you can go away and think about how you'd like to do a different one. And please do, if you find a good scenario, which is very different to some of ours, please feel free to send it in. We're very keen to see people's different ideas. Our thinking is still developing on these issues. This is the first time we've really tried to think hard about this. My thinking has got, this in terms of where my thinking has got to so far, based on the work we've done so far, I guess there's sort of three things that I have in my mind. One is that first point is electric cars on their own, even if they grow really, really rapidly, are unlikely to be a significant game changer for oil demand over the next 20 years. They're just not big enough. Secondly, if electric cars grow in line with what we think, like 100 million cars, but you get a lot of rapid rollout of all these other technologies, car sharing, autonomous driving, ride pooling, then again the numbers don't look big enough. And one of the reasons why here is because all those effects, car sharing, ride pooling, autonomous driving, they're efficiency gains. Those efficiency gains will tend to reduce the cost of car travel. And as you reduce the cost of car travel, that will tend to increase the demand. So there's a sort of natural offsetting effect. But if you have a really rapid rollout of electric cars, say to 200, 300 million cars, and a rapid rollout of all these other technologies focused around electric cars, so autonomous driving electric cars, car sharing electric cars, then the impacts on oil demand can start to get significantly bigger. And sort of the numbers, some of the numbers we found is you could, in that sort of very extreme scenario, you could sort of reduce the growth of global oil demand by around a half over the next 20 years. So rather than growing by 15 million barrels a day, growing by something like 7 million or 8 million barrels a day. So still growing, but you can take a significant amount off if you have a very, very rapid rollout of electric cars, plus a very rapid rollout of all these other technologies alongside it. Okay, that's all I was going to say on the demand question. If we come back to the second question, so the second question was, how might this combination of slowing oil demand be looked at, combined with abundant oil resources, affect the behaviour of oil producers? And the simple point here is there's an abundance of oil. Every year we produce lots and lots and lots of charts in the Energy Outlook, and one chart always thinks, oh, this is my favourite chart. This is my favourite chart of this year's Energy Outlook. The way to read this chart is that multicoloured bar, the stacked bar, shows our estimate of technically recoverable oil resources. So technically recoverable oil resources is a measure which is based on oil resources which we know exist today. So these are oil resources which we know exist and can be recovered with today's technology. Tomorrow, I will find more resource and technology will improve, meaning I can extract even more. But just today's resources with today's technology, we think there's something a little over 2.5 trillion barrels of oil which can be recovered. How do you think about 2.5 trillion barrels of oil? But as you can see here, if you compare it with demand, estimates of demand, 2.5 trillion barrels of oil is enough to meet the world's entire demand for oil out to 2050, twice over. So there's enough oil, technically recoverable oil today, with today's technology, to meet the world's entire demand for oil out to 2050, twice over. Given that, it seems increasingly likely to me that some technically recoverable barrels of oil at some point in the future will not be extracted. Remember thinking about that demand curve sloping downwards, the growth of electric cars. The implications of this, I think, are quite significant. If you think about the oil market, the global oil market over the last 20 years, that's been characterised by low-cost producers and high-cost producers both operating in that market. I find it very hard to think of another market in the world where you one producer can produce the same good at 3 or 4 times the cost of another producer in a highly competitive globalised market and they can stay in business for 20 or 30 years. In any other market, competitive forces would just drive out those high-cost producers out of business. That doesn't happen in the oil market. Why? Because the low-cost producers up till now have effectively rationed their oil supplies with the view that a barrel of oil not produced today can always be produced tomorrow, perhaps at an even higher rate. But in a world where it seems increasingly likely that some barrels of oil won't be produced tomorrow, that sort of strategy seems less compelling. And it seems increasingly likely to me that the low-cost producers will wish to start using their competitive advantage to increase their market share. So in the Energy Outlook, we've assumed that the low-cost producers, and the key low-cost, where is the real low-cost oil? It's onshore giant fields, particularly in Middle East OPEC, particularly in Russia, and to a certain extent, some of the sweet spots in terms of US tight oil. Those low-cost producers gradually increase their market share over time at the expense of higher-cost producers. Now, if this were to happen, the implications are pretty profound in terms of the composition of supply and long-run price trends. So this is quite a profound shift in the behaviour of global oil markets. So the question is, well, how likely is this to happen? I think if I can produce a chart like that on the left, so can many other countries. And my experience of travelling around different parts of the world is I'm not the only person that can look at the amount of oil, potential oil supplies relative to demand, and make this sort of deduction. So I think some movement in this direction seems likely to me. But how much and how quickly, I think, is harder to predict for a number of reasons. There's a sort of pure logistical reason. So if you wish to, suppose Saudi Arabia decided tomorrow that it wanted to increase its production of oil from 10 million barrels a day to 15 million barrels a day, that will take tens, if not hundreds of billions of dollars to do and take many, many years. So increasing production is a relatively slow process, an expensive process. Moreover, this strategy which these low-cost producers are effectively operating here is one where they produce more and accept a lower price. That has all sorts of implications for their real economy, particularly their fiscal finances. So how quickly they do this is also constrained by their real economy. Moreover, the high-cost producers are likely to want to compete to maintain their market share. And they can start to compete and maintain their market share by trying to reduce or changing their tax and royalty regimes. And so we don't know in this, there's also an issue about just how strong that competition would be. So whether we built too much or too little into the outlook, I think is very hard to know. But some shift in this direction of low-cost producers rationing less and trying to use their competitive advantage over time to increase their market share seems quite likely to me. Now, I'm conscious there are many people here that will know far more about the Russian oil industry than I do, so I put that there and wait to be informed about which bit of that sounds right and which bit sounds wrong when I finish. So that's what I was going to say on oil. If I turn next to natural gas, so in the base case, natural gas is expected to grow strongly, growing by around 1.6% per year on average over the next 20 years, far more stronger than either oil or coal. 2/3 of that growth in gas is driven by shale gas, led by the US, where US shale gas doubles over the next 20 years, plus also the emergence of China as a sizable shale gas producer. Within conventional gas, Russian gas also expands, with increased pipeline gas to both Europe in particular, but also Asia, and also the growth of LNG. On the demand side, the key sectors powering the growth of demand is industrial demand and the power sector, with China, the Middle East, and the US the main sources of demand. Now, a big feature of the gas market, which I think I spoke about when I was last here presenting the outlook, is a rapid growth we expect to see in liquefied natural gas, LNG, over the next 20 years. LNG trade grows far more rapidly than pipeline trade, so we expect that LNG will account for more than half of total traded gas by 2035. So there's enormous growth in traded gas. As you can see on the left, that supply is driven by growth in the US in green and Australia in yellow, with the main market for gas on the right-hand side continuing to be Asia. Why does this matter? Why does LNG, this growth of LNG matter? What's the significance of it? The significance of it is because LNG is mobile. It can be diverted from one part of the world to another part of the world in response to a shock. So just take an example here. Suppose this side of the room is Asia, and some event happens, say similar to the Fukushima tragedy, such that the demand for gas goes up very strongly in this side of the room, and prices spike up very significantly. And suppose for a minute I'm Gazprom, and I'm piping my gas into Russia. What do I into Europe? What do I do in response to this massive increase in demand and price spike over here? Nothing. I carry on piping my gas into Europe as if nothing had happened. I can't pick my pipeline up and take it to Asia. So as a result of which, gas prices in Europe are largely unaffected, and gas prices in Asia go really high. These markets are effectively segmented because I can't shift my pipeline. What happens now in a world of LNG? These cargoes start to get diverted. I can go onto BP's trading floor. And if I go onto BP's trading floor, they have an app, which looks a bit like a radar screen which goes round. And on that app, it has every single LNG vessel which is operating at the moment, its cargo, where it's heading to, and the arbitrage opportunities if you tell it to go somewhere else. So in this case, that radar will be screaming at me saying, divert cargoes from Europe and to Asia. So what will happen, as those cargoes are diverted, prices in Asia will start to fall because they've got increased supply. Prices in Europe will start to rise because supply is getting less. And those cargoes will keep on diverting until prices start to become closer into line. So we're moving to a globally integrated gas market, just like we have a globally integrated oil market because of this role of LNG. If you think about the locations, as I said, the two key locations here, the two key sources of LNG are Australia and the US. In terms of Australia, given its location, Australian LNG will normally be absorbed in Asia, because that's where the key market. In contrast, for the US, US LNG supplies are likely to be far more diversified. Some of them go into Asia, some of them go into Europe, and some of them go into Central and Southern America. The significance of this is that diversity of those US of the US LNG exports means, and my guess is that as we move towards a globally integrated gas market, US gas prices are likely to serve as an anchor for those prices, for that global market. Why? Because those US LNG exporters are already actively arbitraging between across these three different markets. So they're a marginal source of gas across all three of these markets. For the Australian LNG exporter, prices would have to move really significantly in some other part of the world for them to divert their cargoes away from Asia. It's a natural home for them to feed into Asia. But for the US exporter, they're already arbitraging across these different markets, and as a result of which, I expect US gas prices to act as the anchor to this globally integrated gas market as we go forward. One other feature of this is, as we develop a sort of deep and competitive market for LNG, I'd expect increasingly for long-term gas contracts to increasingly be written in terms of gas prices rather than in terms of oil. So quite a significant shift in the nature of the global gas market over the next 20 years, driven by this growth of LNG. Final thing I want to talk about is in terms of carbon emissions. In terms of the outlook for carbon emissions, there's some good news and some bad news. The good news is that the combination of that faster decline in energy intensity, those big green bars getting bigger I talked about earlier, together with this shift in the fuel mix, strong growth in renewables, strong growth in natural gas, coal starting to decline, means we expect carbon emissions to grow far less quickly than in the past. So you can see here, we expect carbon emissions to grow by around a third of the rate over the next 20 years than in the past, around 0.6% compared to over 2%. So the implication here is that the global economy can grow at similar rates to the past, but the growth of carbon emissions will be far less than the past. That's the good news. The bad news is that carbon emissions are still growing. On our base case, we expect carbon emissions to grow by a little over 10%. That compares with the IEA 450 scenario, which many people use as sort of the benchmark scenario consistent with achieving the 2 degrees C ambition, that carbon emissions, rather than rising, need to fall quite substantially by around 30% over the next 20 years. And this widening gap between the two highlights the need for more policy action if we're going to achieve the goal set out in Paris. And if you like, when producing the energy outlook, one of the biggest uncertainties we face is how policymakers are going to respond to this widening gap and the speed of transition to a lower carbon world. So to try and respond to think about that uncertainty, we consider in the outlook two alternative faster transition pathways. Some of you may recall that in the last energy outlook, when I came here a year ago, we developed an IEA, we developed a faster transition case, shown here in the green line, which got us roughly halfway between our base case and the IEA 450 scenario. And this year we've updated that faster transition case, shown here in green. But we've also added an even faster transition case, shown here in orange, which essentially mimics and matches the carbon emissions in the IEA 450 scenario. So our even faster case is matching the profile for carbon emissions in the IEA 450 scenario. Now, I think it's fair to say we're getting to the limits of our modelling capabilities in BP in terms of what you would need to actually do to achieve this outcome. Some of these outcomes are defined in terms of actual policy measures. So we have carbon prices. In the base case, they rise to $40 a tonne, rising to $100 a tonne in the faster transition case and to $200 per tonne in the even faster case. Some of it is defined in terms of outcomes. So if in terms of electric cars, we have electric cars penetrating by 200 million in the faster case and 400 million in the even faster case, but we don't actually try and work out what you would need to do to achieve that faster penetration electric cars. We just assume it happens and policymakers have to work out a way of dealing with it. One feature of these faster transition pathways is that much of the abatement happens in the power sector, which you can see here on the right, both in the faster case and the even faster case. What implications would this have for the energy mix? Shown in this chart, energy is still expected to grow, but by significantly slower than in the base case. Non-fossil fuels, shown here by these blue bars, provide all of the net increase in energy demand over this period, with coal falling back sharply. Oil peaks in both cases. But you can see here that in the even faster case, the world needs roughly as much oil and gas combined in 2035 as it does today. So oil and gas consumption combined, even in the even faster case, is roughly the same as today, with oil and gas providing around half of the world's energy needs in 2035. So if you think about the decline rates you see in oil and gas, even in a 2 degrees C case, you still need significant amounts of investment in order to achieve, to provide the oil and gas the world will need, even in a 2 degrees C case. I don't think we would in BP think we have some sort of huge comparative advantage compared to other people in producing these scenarios. There are many other scenarios out there, and I don't think we think ours is necessarily better than anybody else's. So in the main booklet, which you can download, we have a table comparing our scenarios with a range of external scenarios which produce similar declines in carbon emissions, and sort of say, ask the question, where are we different and where are we similar? And there are some similarities. Nearly all of those external projections point to the power sector as the place where you achieve most of the abatement. All point to strong growth in renewable energy. Nearly all point to oil and gas combined providing around half of the world's energy needs in 2035. That's pretty similar across all three. The main difference is the difference between energy intensity in how much of this is done by energy intensity and how much is done by carbon intensity. But that's the main difference between the two. If we I want to make one final point before stopping. So just changing tack slightly. One of the features of the energy outlook is we expect natural gas to grow very strongly over the next 20 years. And I think if you ask most major oil and gas companies about one of the sort of their key views about the future, is that gas will grow strongly over the next 20 years. And so a natural question to ask if you're in my sort of job is, well, where could that go wrong? How could gas demand be a lot weaker than we expected? Because BP's putting big bets on the fact that gas demand will grow strongly, so how could that go wrong? And what we just observed, you can see in these scenarios, in a world where climate policies increase far faster than expected, that squeezes gas demand. Overall energy demand falls. Moreover, gas is squeezed out relative to non-fossil fuels. So one risk to gas is that climate policies are a lot stronger than expected. But another potential risk to gas is that climate policies are a lot weaker than expected. Some of the strength of gas we expect to see over the next 20 years is supported by the assumption of increasing climate policies, which encourage a switch away from coal towards cleaner, lower carbon fuels, some of that renewables, but also some of it natural gas. What happens if that switch doesn't materialise? And we look at that in this alternative case here, in which you can see here the share of natural gas is assumed to actually, in this alternative case, to actually decline over the next 20 years. Now, the policy measures you need to do to achieve that are quite stark. This is equivalent, roughly equivalent to a zero carbon price globally, plus also a rolling back of some of the regulation encouraging a switch away from coal. So the policy measures here are quite profound and quite stark. But it makes a general point, which you can see here on the right-hand chart, that the risk to gas, there's risk to the strength of gas demand, both from climate policies being stronger than expected, but also from them being weaker than expected over the next 20 years. Let me stop there and conclude and then throw it open for questions and hopefully corrections and criticisms. Global energy markets are in a transition. Conventional developed markets are being overtaken by fast-growing emerging economies, particularly in Asia. The fuel mix is gradually decarbonising, with strong growth in renewables, non-fossil fuels providing almost half the growth in energy. The oil market is changing as it adapts to electric cars and the mobility revolution on the demand side, and potentially to this abundance of oil on the supply side. We're moving towards a globally integrated gas market driven by the growth of LNG, and the outlook for carbon emissions is improving, but it's not improving quickly enough, highlighting the need for more carbon policies. Let me stop there and hand it over. Thank you.
Okay. Спасибо большое, Спенсер. Спасибо.